About a year ago, Qualcomm had a big push into the Windows laptop market with their Snapdragon chips. The technology was very promising, if it could even capture a slither of the god-tier efficiency that MacBooks enjoy with their ARM-based Apple Silicon chips. Surely these should have sold like Beanie Babies to your mom, probably. But just like me in the bedroom, unfortunately, after just a couple thrusts, it was over. Okay, that's maybe a little bit dramatic, but I just wanted to make that joke about how I can't satisfy my partner. They sold over 720,000 devices with these chips in them, which may only represent a tiny percentage of total PC sales, but considering how borderline unusable this device was when I bought it a year ago, I'm surprised that many people bought them. I wonder if that 720,000 includes the apparent frequent returns of these devices. But either way, according to Qualcomm, that 720,000 represents 10% of PCs sold at over $800 in the US, which is way more than the 5 sales I was expecting. But now it's been a year, and considering that there are a surprising amount of people using these devices, I think it's worth checking out how much the Windows ARM experience has improved. And considering that gaming is the only thing I know how to do on a computer, we're gonna use that for the majority of this evaluation today, which I think is very useful considering how these are definitely gaming devices. But before we get into that, when you're traveling, nothing hits better than some cellular peace of mind. That's why today's video is sponsored by UBG, a powerful eSIM service that works in over 200 destinations. UBG will get you amazingly priced data packages all over the world. And with no hidden roaming fees, they can save you up to 90%. And what's really awesome is that UBG is the only eSIM that lets you recharge your data packages without actual internet connection. So if you watch too many David Does Tech Stuff episodes in the middle of the Sahara Desert, you can easily recharge even with no data left. So check if your device is compatible by typing *#06#, and if an EID number shows up, use the promo code David to get an additional 10% off some UBG action using the link down below. Now, the main reason I want to test some ARM gaming on Windows again is because since the last time I did this, about a year ago, there has been two major updates to Microsoft's ARM gaming implementation. The first, and probably the most consequential one, is that Microsoft has updated its Prism translation layer, which is basically the thing that allows ARM hardware to interact with non-ARM software, i.e. most video games. As far as I understand it, one of their main focuses has been on game compatibility, which was a huge issue before. I think I got like 2 or 3 games running on that laptop, and not very well. Now I'm gonna test a bunch of games in this video, but for those of you that are interested in a more comprehensive list of compatibility, there's a website that not only breaks down which games will work, but it gives you a rough idea of what kind of performance you should expect. And aside from games, it also lists application compatibility. So for anybody that's ARM curious, this is a very useful tool. The second reason why I wanted to make this video was just last week, Microsoft announced an Xbox app update, which allows for much better ARM gaming, apparently. Now, as far as I can tell, the main update is that the Xbox app now allows you to download games locally onto your ARM device and then run it on the little system. Now, I didn't know this because I never used the Xbox app, but apparently before, with an ARM device, you could only use the Xbox app for cloud gaming. Now, considering the performance I'm expecting from this laptop, I can't imagine this is going to be a very useful update, but I'm really curious to see how it turns out. But with that, let's fire up our little laptop, do a bunch of Windows updates, and see how much better it games. The first thing I did after getting a jump scare from this weird visual artifact I forgot about was install the laundry list of Windows updates, hoping that it would fix the problem. Hey, that's fixed our screen. Okay. And aside from an antivirus update, it seemed like we had the freshest version of Windows 11 available at time of writing. And it was also nice to see all this experimental AI crap that comes with these co-pilot ARM devices. But with that, I plugged in an external monitor and was ready to do some gaming. I'm gonna start off with CS2, because the first time around, it initially launched, then I changed the resolution, which broke the game and I couldn't get it running again. So hopefully that's been fixed in the last year and we can actually play it now.
A few moments later.
It might just be extremely slow because we're using USB-A.
Approximately 10 hours later.
Oh, this is starting off very promising. Then, after another 20 minutes of waiting, I decided to Control-Alt-Delete, end task, and then try again. That's a fun artifact. I wonder...
I hope the screen capture is picking it up.
And I'm kind of scared to change any settings, so I just wanted to look at it. But even changing settings didn't break it this time, which means I think they may have fixed CS2 on ARM.
Wow.
A whole 30 frames per second, when we're lucky. Walp. Oh, it's worse than 30. It is so inconsistent in its frame pacing, because there is some crazy dips happening. I'm pretty sure that a big part of the initial performance we were getting was because of a CPU bottleneck, because now that there are fewer bots alive, the game is running better. I'm gonna go reinstall MSI Afterburner, and I'm gonna see if I can get a more comprehensive stat overlay. Reinstalling it didn't help, but I could use hardware info to at least give us a rough idea of what the GPU and CPU are doing. Yeah, we're getting very low GPU utilization. It's hovering around 60. Now we are only getting about 23% on our CPU, but in all fairness, that is total CPU usage. So there could be just one core that's really struggling. I then turned on some balanced fidelity FX, which gave us a bit of a nudge in frame rate, which at this point, I guess if you've never played on a better system before, is kind of a usable CS2 experience. Also, it works now when it didn't before, which is exciting. I then decided to try some Doom Eternal. Which the last time I tried it hit us with the unknown vendor ID failure. But this time it worked.
That's wild. There's like many more games running. Wow, look at that. We can now play Doom Eternal with a wildly inconsistent 40-ish frames per second. I mean, it is all over the place, my word.
The game looks so bad, but at least now that we've been gaming for a while, the frame rate has stabilized quite a lot. So I think this is a good example of the kind of max power gaming-wise we're gonna get out of this thing, because we're using about 100% of our GPU, and at 1080p low settings, Doom Eternal is, I mean, kinda depending on what's going on in the scene, reasonably usable. Now, Starfield was another game that refused to work, so let's see if it launches this time.
At this point, it just as well could not run. Like, this is... this is wildly unusable. Wait, we're gonna have to drop settings here. So we're gonna turn FSR on.
Dropping the render scale to 60% helped a little bit. We jumped from 7 to about 12 frames per second, which I guess is quite a big percentage jump, but it still felt equally terrible. Granted, it looked pretty good. It wasn't super obvious that we were using a butt ton of upscaling. I then decided to drop the base resolution, which required me to use windowed mode for some reason. Either way, at 1080p with 50% resolution scale, things were getting better.
Wow, we're slowly getting there.
Finally, I dropped the base resolution to 720p.
And we're getting about 18. I mean, it's not playable, but it is way better than it was before. And the game is actually running, which it didn't do a year ago. So that is an improvement, although unfortunately, now it means we have to play Starfield, which, is that an improvement?
And then finally, before we try some Xbox app games, I want to see if Cyberpunk performs any better than it did when we tested it a year ago.
Oh yeah, look at that. This is peak Snapdragon performance. We have updated drivers and an extra year of just general better systemness, and it gives us about 20 frames per second. This is peak gaming.
And in terms of canned benchmark, we jumped up from an average of 17 to 26 frames per second. That's massive. Still terrible, but massive.
And interestingly, we're not getting that VHS effect distortion that we saw last year while trying this, although that could be because I'm using an external monitor for our screen capture situation. So I will test after the fact, just like on the normal screen.
Nope, even on the laptop's display, the effect was much less pronounced than before.
However, I will say, it does look pretty smoothed over texture-wise, which is interesting because it was the same with Doom Eternal. Doom Eternal looked very flat compared to what I'm used to that game looking like.
At which point it was time to get to change number 2, Xbox app update. Now, after installing the Xbox app, I wanted to try some of this infamous Xbox cloud gaming just to see what the experience is like on this ARM device. So I fired up some Halo Infinite, and it was fine. Visually, the game looked good, but there was quite a lot of input latency, making the game pretty difficult. Or maybe that's just an excuse, and the reason I was sucking was because as a non-American, I never really got into the whole Halo thing. Anyway, after that, I couldn't quite figure out how to download the games onto the device. Well, it turns out, because it's an experimental feature, you have to kind of beg Microsoft to give you access to the ability to download the games. Well, once my begging was effective, I decided to download Doom Eternal on the Xbox Store to see if there was any performance variation compared to the Steam download. Well, luckily for Xbox, there wasn't. In fact, the game just refused to run for some reason, so I couldn't even compare the two. So yeah, it's not really worked out too well for the Xbox app, has it? I then downloaded Starfield, which also didn't work. It kind of baited me into thinking it would by launching, but it would just crash every time it finished updating its shaders or whatever. So apparently this Xbox beta just doesn't work. It's broken at this point, which I guess means we need to wait another year for that to work. And then finally, I also tried Half-Life 2 again, which gave a slightly more stable frame rate than before, and it didn't have that weird flickering artifact that we got last year, which is good. Which brings me to the end of the video. Thank you for watching. Let me know down below what you think of ARM in 2025. Subscribe on the way down there, and until the next video, thank you for watching. Bye-bye.